Session meeting for July 14th, 2015. May I have a roll call vote, please, Madam Clerk?
Dr. Elliott?
Here.
Mrs. Kreiling?
Here.
Mr. Lane?
Here.
Mr. Moorman?
Here.
Mr. Schreiber?
Here.
Mr. Powers?
Here.
Mr. Markison?
Here. Thank you. We have Dr. Elliott on the phone, who's been pulled away for work, and will be participating by phone. First of all, happy summer, everybody. This is our last meeting before we start the 15-16 school year, and I'd like to officially welcome Dr. Holland to Lake Forest High School and her first of many board meetings. Welcome, Shayla. We have important business on the agenda tonight, and I'd like to use my president's report to first introduce one agenda item, the LFEA contract. All of us had different reasons for wanting to join the board. I had two. First, to continue to improve the emotional health of all LFHS students. My family has had some firsthand experience with this, and I understand how important this is to the community. The second, which I want to talk about now, why did we have a strike? I learned quickly the reasons are many and complicated, mostly connected to breakdowns in communication. I was very heartened to hear that the prior board, Mr. Simic and his whole team, plus the Teachers Association leadership, have been working on rebuilding trust and improving communications since the 2012 strike and have made tremendous progress in the last 3 years. It hasn't always been smooth. There have been bumps, as there are in any relationship. But there was a strong consensus and a shared commitment to redefining our relationship and working together differently, more collaboratively versus confrontationally and in a controlling manner. The two previous board presidents, Messrs. Bergner and Block, and our senior board members, notice I didn't call them old, Messrs. Powers, Schreiber, and Moorman, deserve the credit for this historical first. It would have been easy to revert to the old norm. Dr. Elliott, Mrs. Kreiling, and Mr. Lane have been a critical part of the review because of their new, fresh perspective and questioning of old assumptions. The Teachers Association, administration, and the board agreed over the winter to begin discussions on a long-term contract. Even though the current contract had one more year, we all agreed it would be a good idea to start talking now, before the deadline, and eliminate any possible disruption of a new school year. This is very important. We all committed to approaching it differently, collaboratively. We agreed on our goals up front. We listened, we compromised, and worked towards those mutual goals. The LFEA leadership, administration, and the board met every Monday afternoon and sometimes well into the evenings for about 10 weeks with several productive sidebar meetings to come up with the agreement before us today. We believe we successfully changed the way we worked and I think created a new dynamic for continued collaboration. I want to thank the team of seven elected by the LFEA for their time and for approaching every one of our discussions in an open, collaborative fashion. It speaks to the spirit of our new relationship, the educational process, what's best for our students, and the future. Thank you. Mr. Simic, would you like to take it from here?
Sure. Now we'll continue on with the superintendent's report.
Superintendent's report.
Okay, very good. And I'd like to begin the superintendent's report with, and I have other comments that I will share when we get to that agenda item, unless you'd like me to share those now.
No, superintendent's report.
Okay, good. And I will first hand off to Dr. Holland.
Oh, good evening. So, the high school is buzzing. Summer school is going very well under the leadership of our assistant principal, Jim Sullivan. We're in the second semester of summer school, and we have an increase this summer. We have a total of 385 students attending summer school, which is an increase of 47%. We're very excited about the new course offerings and the level of engagement of our students this summer. We have some summer construction going on. We have our new front doors complete. We have a robotics room under construction, as well as our college resource center. And that's everything's moving along and scheduled as moving along nicely. Our student schedules and packets will be mailed early next week, and our freshman orientation is scheduled for August 21st. And all incoming freshmen and families should expect to receive a letter with orientation details in the first week of August. But we advise everyone to continue to check the website for additional information. But other than that, everything is going well during summer school. Our assistant principals are working very hard, as well as our teachers, finishing up some curriculum work, and all is well. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Holland. This month has been largely devoted to preparing the strategic planning update, which you'll be seeing in a few moments here, and also getting our new principal started in her new role. I'd like to thank the team around us for helping both of those things come together. It's always a group effort. The strategic planning update will follow in just a few minutes, so my comments are going to reflect what I have seen and heard from Dr. Holland's start with us. I'm very pleased to see that Dr. Holland has been so proactively engaged in a variety of stakeholder meetings in the communities, which includes students, support staff, eager teachers dropping in to visit, and our parent and resident communities. Anecdotal feedback from those encounters reflect what we have heard from both Evanston and Oak Park River Forest. Comments like, she's chill, she's a great listener, she has a great sense of humor once you get to know her, and so on. In those meetings, she impresses with her breadth of experience on issues that are important to us, expanding student supports, instructional observation, and large, complicated group processes. She is at once an eager listener and an eager participant in conversation, adding value through each. It's also clear that Dr. Holland has only one gear, which is fast forward in devotion to good experiences and improved outcomes for students. And welcome on board. And it's really a really good start. So thank you.
Now is the time for a public participation. Just let me review the process quickly. Interested speakers should come to the microphone, state their name before addressing the board. In the interest of everyone's time, please limit your address to 3 minutes. We'll remind you when you're near the limit. Everyone has the right within reason to be heard respectfully. Public comment should not be redundant. The board will not respond to questions. This is our opportunity to listen. Detailed questions posed to the board will be taken under advisement. If the public has any letters or any other written materials, they may be handed to the board clerk for the public record. And after a reasonable time, I reserve the right to end public comment, which I won't set right now. So are there any members of the public that would be interested in addressing the board? No public comment. Reports, finance.
Yes, we had a finance meeting. Our finance meeting took place yesterday. It was an additional meeting that we added on to the regular schedule that we communicated back in April, mostly because of all of the key issues and projects, particularly around the budget, which we'll be talking about a little bit later. But we reviewed the fiscal 16 budget, which you'll see in detail, so I won't bore you with that. We've continued to talk about refinancing $10 million worth of our bond. And with everything that's going on in Greece, you know, there's a good time, there's a bad time, there's a better time, there's a worse time. We've been watching that very diligently, or I should say Alan has, since he's much more qualified to do that than I am. But we're constantly consulting with William Blair, who is our partner in this process, and we think that there's a nice opportunity for us in the coming months to be able to act on that and save the taxpayers some dollars over the next several years. So you'll hear more about that from us going forward. We talked about some operational service policies. Just give you a quick example, and again, this is on the agenda for an action item later. But as you might imagine, our fiscal year ends in June, And there are a lot of checks that need to be written oftentimes to close that out when the new budget hasn't yet but put forth to the public for review. And it's, again, it's a tentative budget that you're going to see this evening. It'll be posted for 30 days, and we won't act on that until the September or October timeframe. But because of that, we made some slight changes that allow the administration to write some of those checks. Our Leading Edge initiative, which is outfitting our entire school this year, really sophomores, juniors, and seniors with laptop computers. That's a perfect example. Those purchases need to take place now so we can order the equipment, we can train the kids, and we can be ready for back to school. We made a subtle change there. We'll talk about that. We also made a change with our third-party administrator around our dental plan for all of our teachers. There's a technicality. We're making a change in the broker of record first, and then we're going to introduce a new opportunity, which is savings for the taxpayers. It's actually a better program that we have out there now, so we're looking forward to doing that. And then I am a delinquent in identifying the finance and operation meeting dates for next year. I think I promised Alan that by the end of the week, so we can get those published on the calendar, so everybody will know when those meetings are, starting in the September-October timeframe. I think we're probably going to overschedule some of those meetings now, because it's easier to cancel one than there is to throw another one on the calendar, and I want to make sure that we give visibility over that to everybody involved. So that's the end of the finance and operations report.
Dr. Elliott, I don't believe there's been an education committee meeting since the last meeting, so I won't ask you to talk over the phone. Are there any liaison reports?
The NSSCD board did not meet this month, although on the 23rd and 27th there are informational meetings at Deerfield High School referencing their wish to depart the consortium of 18 districts. And if anybody's interested, it'll be 7:30 in the morning on the 24th and 7 p.m. on the 27th. That's all I have.
Mr. Simic, can I call on you for a strategic planning committee report?
Dr. Steve Cordigan and I are going to tag team on this. So what was in the board packet is also available online. So what the board members sees here, board members see here, is the same thing that the public sees as well. And then on the district website, if you go to lfhs.org, you can put in mission and vision or strategic plan and find a very detailed accordion, if you will. You can click down and drill down into all sorts of information items related to the district strategic plan. So I'm going to begin, and then I'm going to ask Dr. Cordigan to present some of the assessment data, and then I will wrap up, and then we'll finish with whatever questions the board members may have. So a major overview of the updates in the strategic plan, what we have looked at from achievement, we have focused on AP access and also AP enrollment, what that enrollment has done with instruction. One of the major initiatives there has been the Leading Edge. The board last month approved the purchase of laptops for the freshman, junior, and senior classes, a very substantial investment. That's gone extremely well. With innovation, we have had co-teaching and co-planning on a variety of different courses. This year we began a couple, and next year we added even more, some brand new things and very robust enrollment for those. With assessment, it's not a very exciting thing to talk about, a guaranteed and viable curriculum, but what it does is it lays the foundation for all sorts of really important work. It looks at consistency across a grade of what kids are being taught and what the expectations are for them, a very, very important thing. For talent, we've spent a huge amount of time this year working on student growth, the student growth component. Next year, at the end of next year, the beginning of the following year, 30% of teacher evaluations have to have growth as a p- part of the teacher evaluation. So we had many days set aside for this school year. Dr. Wilcox has led that group and facilitated that group, looking at how do we do this. It sounds very easy. It is a very complicated thing. So a great deal of learning going on there with partnerships. We'll be talking later on in the meeting about the LFEA agreement. That's certainly a key initiative for us, as well as the CSCI, that is the climate survey for our, from our parents, our students, and our teachers, looking at our social and emotional well-being. And for the environment, we have a couple significantly redesigned spaces. The Innovation Incubator is one. This summer, Mrs. White is working on an improved robotics or maker space down in what used to be the freshman study hall. And with that, I'm going to ask Dr. Cordigan to come up and present some of his slides on our assessment data.
Hi, I'm Steve Cordigan. I served as Director of Research and Evaluation at Township High School District 214 for 11 years and Director of Research at Illinois Mathematics and Science Academy for the 7 years prior to that. I've spoken to some of you before on academic performance assessment. I'm here today to present an overview of recent Lake Forest High School academic performance data, which is going to focus on the increase in course rigor and the outcomes from those efforts. Now, increasing course rigor can be viewed in terms of placement into more rigorous courses, particularly honors and AP courses. Assuming that all students are exposed to more rigorous coursework, other measures of academic performance should increase accordingly. Therefore, we'll also take a look at overall ACT performance across recent years. Okay, ideally, students will be placed in courses whose rigor is appropriate to their achievement level. And Tom, please feel free to join in if you have any additional comments to make. However, some changes in initial placement always will be needed to tweak those placements to make sure that the course is the best possible fit for the student. The percentage, in general, changes in placements have gone down, but more importantly, the percentage of the relatively few students whose placements change upward has increased in the past 3 years by 23.3%. At the same time, students opting for courses of less rigor have shifted downward by 36.4%. Now, Lake Forest, as you know, is a little different from most of the rest of the suburbs in that courses that are designated as honors level accelerated or even double accelerated in most other districts are considered regular courses here. So the increased enrollment in honors and AP courses, when you consider that, you have to realize that even your regular courses would be considered highly rigorous honors courses elsewhere. So AP courses, now, they're not only more rigorous, they're also part of a national program of standardized subject area tests that can earn a student college level credit. Lake Forest has implemented an expansion of AP both through more course offerings and through reducing restrictions on being able to enroll in the courses. Such strategies not only have proven essential in expanding AP participation, they have also had an actual minimal effect on overall AP score levels. One of the fears of expanding AP and having more students in it is that your performance is going to drop. But the experience is generally that that sort of drop, if the expansion is handled carefully, can be very minimal. And we've basically found that non-honor students can be successful in AP courses. Successful AP placement is best measured by combining both
that a year ago when we put this budget together. Additionally, we came up about $100,000 short in our expected revenue from Little Scouts downstairs. Our enrollment is less than what was projected. However, Little Scouts still ended the year in the black because our expenses were less than projected because we had less staff. And then finally, our federal reimbursement on room and board was actually $275,000 less than we anticipated. And that's just a very difficult number to budget because that's very dependent on outplaced special ed students, and that can vary from month to month or day to day. If you add up the three numbers I just gave you, you exceed the 616. Obviously, then some revenue lines came in above where we expected. But the real variance in this budget is on the expense side. We had a spending plan of $47.4 million, and we only spent $45 million. So we underspent by $2.3 million. This slide shows all the different funds in the district and the variance that occurred in the individual funds. So in the educational fund, we expected to spend $32.7 million, but we only spent $31.7 million. So we underspent by $1 million. And I won't go through each of the funds, but I do want to highlight two of them, and we'll spend a little time talking about the educational fund and then capital projects. You see it was underspent by $809,000. Please feel free to stop me at any time if there's questions along the way or if you need clarity. So within each fund, there's categories of expenses. And this is prescribed by the state. So we have salaries, benefits, purchase services, supplies, capital outlay, other tuition, and termination benefits. So if we go through each one of those object lines, you can see how they performed. We were $543,000 under budget in salaries. Now a year ago, that's about a 2.4% variance. A year ago, we were a 1% variance. And that would be more typical, and that's what we kind of target. Even though we build the budget on a person-by-person basis, there are still variables that occur that we don't control. Substitute costs, medical leaves, lane advancements on educational credits. We came in under budget on benefits as well, which is a little unusual because if you look at these two, that's 80% of the entire variance here. What occurred in purchase services, supplies, capital outlay, other tuition, and this is where our special ed tuition is. So while we came up short on the revenue side, we were short on the expense side because we weren't paying that out. So we're at a point where we get reimbursed in the same year that we're incurring the expense. So that explains why that revenue number was short a little earlier. These variances here, I would call pretty normal, but these were a little high for us. So we wanted to go in, we drilled down some more. This past year, we experienced the passing of a staff member. We had two unanticipated leaves of absence and a mid-year resignation. Those four actions alone amounted to about $300,000 in salary. So there was some offset there, but adjusting that out puts us much more in the norm of what we're used to, of that 1%. There's a trickle-down effect now, because if you're not spending it in salary, you're not going to incur it in benefits, on TRS payments, and likely in health insurance payments. The other fund that I wanted to highlight was our capital projects fund. We had a budget of $930,296. We actually spent $120,750, so we underspent that fund by $809,546. The variance that occurred here, we had budgeted in this number the complete spend down of the bond proceeds that we issued a couple years ago when we built the track and identified a number of other projects. There are a couple of big ones in there. We had some storage buildings. We're going to talk about one of those a little later on tonight. We had auditorium rigging, replacing the rigging system in the auditorium as well, and I believe a cooling tower. All of those amounted to about $400,000. None of those got completed in this fiscal year. A lot of them, on the storage building and on the rigging system, it really was engineering issues in working through those. They will occur. The storage building, we hope you act on tonight at East Campus, and that the rigging probably will not take place until next June, which will hit the next fiscal year. So it's a little deceptive to look at that and look at the underspending of the $2.3 million without drilling down and drawing any conclusions from it, because a lot of it, $800,000, will get spent. It's just a timing issue. And then what occurred on the salaries and benefits was extraordinary. I've been doing this a long time. I'd rather stand here and talk to you about underspending on the salaries than on years where we've gone over because of lane changes or adding on classes. What that means, though, is if you look at our financial balance through the Great Recession, and this starts out in 07, this is in 08, in 09, our fund balance was dropping. And the board has a fund balance policy of trying to maintain 10% of our expenditures. So we knew in 08 that we were going to be dropping down below that level. And we implemented a series of actions to try and restore that balance. And we have restored that. And based on what we talked about in this last fiscal year, because this year right here is FY14, that'll add about 3% more to the fund balance. So we're going to be up in the 17% range, 17-18% range, as we start FY16. Okay? Any questions on that so far? Because I wanted to paint where we've been before I talk about where we're going.
Alan, I have a quick question. First, a comment. I think, you know, obviously prior boards have had a lot of experience with this, particularly on the downside of this, and they really deserve the credit from a path to black. Some of you in the public may have heard that statement, and that was the strategy that prior boards put in place to really get this fund balance back up. So I want to commend Alan and his team for really managing through that pretty skillfully. My question then is related to the categorical payments from the state. You know, I'll be the first to say I'm somewhat skeptical in terms of what those payments look like consistently going forward. And it's one of the things that Alan and I and the Finance and Operations Committee talk about pretty regularly. And not that we're waiting for the sky to fall, but I mean, clearly we have some issues and concerns about our budget from a state perspective. What kind of confidence that you have? So they didn't pay us the third payment for this year. Do we have a high degree of confidence that they're going to make up for that, or is, you know, how do we try to manage for that going forward? And I'm just interested in kind of your color commentary on, you know, having been doing this for a long time, kind of how you and Jen and the team manage it.
Several years ago, under the Quinn administration, the state did something very similar. They delayed state payments, and that's how it's been communicated to us regarding the fourth quarter payment from last year, is that it was being delayed. The state could have said it's being eliminated. They haven't said that. We have been told, and we learned in May, to expect in this budget year that we're talking about now to only expect three payments as well. The one owed to us from last year, plus only two for this current fiscal year. But when you look over the 2 years, that means we would have received three payments last year and then three payments in this fiscal year. I think it's important when they say that they're delayed and they're paying us last year's payment. Now, there's a lot going on in Springfield. You know, we don't know what that final outcome will be. So it is possible that they could come out and say, you know, that payment we owe you, it's now gone. But that hasn't happened. That didn't happen through the Quinn administration. And what's been communicated to this point, that hasn't happened. So what we've built in, and that's a good segue into the next slide, are what are some of the assumptions that we have in the budget? Well, on the local side, which is almost entirely property taxes, we've increased that by slightly more than 1.5% because that's the CPI in the tax cap formula. But on the state revenue side, we're assuming three categorical payments in FY15 at last year's prorated levels. We're not assuming that they're going to catch up and pay us five payments. We're only assuming three. We're also assuming that a pension cost shift of 0.5% will come along on certified salaries. Now, we could be wrong on the configuration of that, but the state doesn't have the money to pay out, so something's going to change. Speaker Madigan wants the cost shift. Speaker Madigan usually in the end gets what he's looking for. So we built that in. And then we'll keep monitoring to see. When you total all of this up, that's probably a reduction of $400,000 to $500,000 in assumed revenue for the coming year. Nothing officials come from the state saying you're only going to get three categorical payments. That's just what we hear in talking to individuals at the state board. The federal side is mainly reimbursement of special ed costs, and that's a really small percent. It's about 3 or 4% of our budget. So it's a double-edged sword. Most of our revenue comes from local sources, which is property taxes. I say it's a double-edged sword because property taxes in Illinois are very high compared to most states. But they are a stable source of revenue, and they are a predictable source, unlike the state. So in some ways, we benefit by not being as reliant on the state as many districts are. Now, the discussion about when they'll catch up on payments or if they'll catch up really will be something we'll talk about in finance in the fall, because that really folds into our five-year financial projection. But for this one-year spending plan, these are the assumptions around revenue that we built in.
Well, and I think the other great thing about Lake County, for all of you out there that I know pay your property taxes just like I do, we'll have all our revenues by September, right? So we paid a June payment, which obviously was in last fiscal year. We'll have the payment in September, and therefore we'll have a much better indication as to, you know, how, you know, really what our baseline is from a starting point, right?
Correct. On the expense side of the ledger, we budget annually salaries and benefits on an individual basis, meaning literally take person by person, name by name, what they're scheduled to receive by contract or by board approval. Same thing on the benefits side, what health plan people select, what the board's contribution to that health plan is. Now, of course, there's always variances. So as people come and go, it's never static. But by doing that, we have a lot of confidence and we take a lot of pride in what we're doing. So again, when we saw the variance like we saw in FY15, we go back and drill down to try and figure out why. But that's more of the anomaly than the norm. When we get to purchase services, supplies, capital outlay, there's a variety of methods used. Some are based on historical and or projected expenses. Utilities are a great example of that. What do we think are happening with rates? What do we hear from the co-op that we participate in? What was last year like weather-wise? You know, was it a warm year? Was it a cold year? Was there a lot of snow? Because that can impact our O&M overtime budget. So we walk through all those things and make assumptions regarding those. A lot of supply costs are based on historical data. What percent have we spent? What are we hearing from the building as far as adequacy of budget? Capital outlay, other, and tuition is based on a per student basis as much as we can. And capital outlay or capital improvements, we try to fit in as revenue streams allow. And we try to strike a balance between maintaining our facilities and maintaining or improving our instructional programs. So for FY16, when we go through all that, the assumptions we've made on the state, the planned initiatives, which we'll talk about in a moment, the projection is that we're going to be spending more than we take in FY16. But we're starting with a very healthy launching point with our fund balance. Some of the highlights that are included in this budget.
Alan, just a quick question on that last slide. I've been hearing about this thing called zero-based budgeting. And how does zero-based budgeting work in an environment like ours? Is that just a euphemism for things that we're already doing? Can you make any comments on that?
Zero-based is, Dick Block and I used to talk about this. He would say it's based on what a revenue stream allows, and in part he's right. But for example, on capital projects, that's based year by year. And we look at individual projects, and we also try to schedule those where we can fit those in over multiple years where the revenue stream will allow. But we don't approach it on, we spent $500,000 last year, so we're going to spend $500,000 this year. It's based on the project. It's based on the need. And again, trying to maintain facilities. We don't want the facilities to run down. It's the best example. There may be, and Barry will come up in a moment, we'll look at some individual projects like the Innovation Incubator. You know, those were one-time costs that we targeted, we tried to build it and around, we looked where we could pick up efficiencies in other areas to fund that. But zero-based budgeting is simply starting at zero. I would argue we do that on our salaries, which are our biggest expense, because we build it person by person, year in and year out. But it's, there's never one method that you apply to an entire budget, so it's just different segments. I'm going to invite Barry up if he wants to comment on these items and also some other ones that may not have, you may not see as big a dollar impact. They may be reallocation of dollars, but there are a lot of things going on at the building.
Thank you. And I think it's important to note as we started the approach budget, we also want to make sure that we connected clearly to the mission and vision to the strategic plan that we were working on and have been working on, and really making sure that that is a living document. One of the items that's covered as a core element in the actual strategic plan talks about environment and making sure that Lake Forest High School has an inspiring environment, state-of-the-art, cutting-edge environment. And so as follows, our initiatives and our planning, what you're going to see is some really, really exciting things happening. First of all, we have a robotics maker space. And for those familiar with the make movement, it's the idea that students are actually using technology, using materials, using ideas, using one another in a collaborative environment to create and to make things. We now live in an information-rich environment where the tools at mankind's disposal are like none other before. So we think it's our charge to make sure that our students are using those tools, can leverage those tools, and that goes for anything that they may do. So in this maker space, we're going to have 3D printing technology, which is state of the art. You think about what we did this year with the Innovation Incubator, where students were coming up with their own businesses, developing a business product or idea. One of the product ideas, for instance, was a device that you could mount onto your sink. And so our students went out and figured out, how can we do this? How can we make this? And actually went out and had someone prototype it. Now we can prototype those things in-house. And so connecting to the curriculum, connecting to achievement, and I think these initiatives are best when you actually start to overlap, when you start to kind of get a force multiplier of all these different initiatives working together. How does this affect achievement? How does this affect instruction? We're now seeing that other courses are excited about this particular space. So we're going to launch it with our robotics team. Our robotics team will actually be building the robots and fabricating some of their own equipment. But we also have an existing class in material science. Our students are very excited. We have a design course in the art department, and our classes are very excited about this new initiative. So it's a very exciting thing, and it's something that's going to, I think, inspire kids and help our students be the leaders of tomorrow. When you talk about leading edge, you always think about that $600,000, a big number that's out there to make sure that the devices are in our hands of our students and our teachers. And really, this is about putting the best tools in the hands of the best educators and the best students. And so you know that there's the obvious part about the technology, but what you don't know, and I think Alan had referenced some of the curricular work that is done behind that. So as we start to look at these initiatives, it's important to have the right technology. But to really leverage this is really about getting great conversations, understanding how to use the equipment, understanding how to best use it for our 21st century skills. So the idea of creativity, collaboration, communicating, hopefully I can communicate the word communicate, and critical thinking. So lots of exciting things. We're also starting to see things where, for instance, they're cost neutral. And Mr. Elbus referenced that. So taking our existing resources and repurposing them, taking existing courses. For instance, we had this year, we actually had an interdisciplinary course between English and social studies. It wasn't a new allocation of resources. It was just using those resources that much better. Next year, we're going to have a very, very exciting class where our environmental science students actually partner with public policy and get out into the community. They'll utilize our transportation that we already have in the building to get out there to places like Eloa Farms, get out to City Hall, get out to the Botanic Gardens, and do lots of exciting things. So as we embark on the next school year, we're very excited about this. We're also very excited that a lot of these things provide supports for students, too, and connections to students. So one of the parts is baked in with leading edge learning is that whole idea of the yoga studio. So as we actually have students and teachers that are faced with this brand new technology, they actually have a resource, 24/7 assistance, and I'm letting them use that to the best of their ability. So I think overall, again, I like to say it's a very sound, I think, wise way to spend the money, but it connects strongly to our mission, vision, our strategic plan, and again, leveraging it so that our students and our teachers can do the best they possibly can. Thank you.
On the facility side, a couple of highlights are the East and West Campus storage facilities, and you'll see that I've crossed out the word and West here. We'll talk about that a little later in the agenda. The cost of building the type of storage facility to do the type of work that needs to be done at East Campus is much higher than we thought. When we issued the bonds a couple years ago, we had allocated money for building a storage facility at East and one at West. We have a need here as well. We have a greater need at East Campus. So what we're proposing to do is take the funds allocated to West Campus, apply them to the East Campus storage facility, and construct that in this coming year. As far as West Campus goes, then that's something we're going to have to work in out of operational funds in a future year. We have asphalt replacement of about $50,000 projected, a tractor and a mower purchase of about $90,000, and vehicle replacement of about $30,000. Now there's a lot of other activities that go on. I'm just pulling out several of them from our capital projects plan, and that's something that we review once or twice a year in our finance and facilities meetings. So when we put all those assumptions together about what's going to happen with health insurance, what's happening with salaries, what's happening with staffing, what's happening with state revenues, what's happening with interest earnings, you'll see in our operating funds, so these are all our funds except capital projects, and I'll talk about that in a moment. We anticipate $46.8 million in revenue, and we project to spend spend $47.5 million in expenses. So the deficit is $696,000. But if you remember the slide, the rainbow-colored slide I had up there several slides ago, our fund balance right now is sitting at about 17%. So this does not jeopardize our financial strength of the district. This is a result of the assumptions around state revenues and the planned initiatives for FY16. When we add in capital projects, which are highlighted down here, we show $275,000 of revenue and expenses of $565,000. Now, the reason I segregated this is because a lot of this expense is the spend down of bond proceeds that we issued several years ago. So that's always going to show as a negative, depending on the timing of when you spend it. So when you add the two together, the variance is $986,000 on revenues to expenses. To summarize, as I just said, the budget is unbalanced due to planned initiatives, assumptions around timing of state payments, assumed pension cost shift, and spend down of bond proceeds. The district will remain financially strong as the fund balance will remain above the policy target of 10%. So that drawdown would be in the 2% range. So we're still going to be around 14, 15, 16%.
Just touching on that, how does it look in out years?
That's one thing we'll spend a lot of time on in the fall as well. And I'm very comfortable with where we are today with the way schools are funded today. So the qualifier on that is there's a lot of talk in Springfield. We don't know what's going to come out of there. We've heard about a two-year property tax freeze. That's gotten a lot of buzz in the last couple of weeks. We've also heard the governor talk about a new pension plan that would freeze salaries for 5 years. We've heard about picking up pension payments for Chicago or the pension cost shifts to the suburbs. Until we know what the playing field looks like, it's hard to make that assessment. But based on our current financial position and the way schools are currently funded, we're comfortable with it because we're also entering a period of declining enrollment.
Could you talk, we talked a little bit about this at the Finance Committee meeting yesterday about the, the state budget report that's been posted on our website and the difference between that, those numbers and your first bullet point that says our budget is unbalanced.
Oh, the state considers this a balanced budget because we have the fund balance to cover this, and I would too, because there are going to be years you're going to have planned initiatives that may draw down on that fund balance. I don't consider this, we're not in a structural deficit. One other variant so that occurs that gets very, very confusing when you look at the state form versus the numbers that we put up. State form numbers are higher because the state requires us on the budget to put what are called on behalf payments as revenue. Well, we never receive the money, so we never budget it. And our practice is what most school districts are. But there is that variance there. And it's frustrating as heck. is when we go to do things at times and we have to pull data out, we have to be cognizant of that number. Yes. Yep. So the administration recommends that the tentative budget be placed on public display and that September 8th be the date established for a public hearing on the budget. Again, approving putting the budget on display is not approving the budget. It's putting it out there for a period of public review. The figures in the budget can be changed up until the time of adoption. So, and we may even come back and recommend changes if we get news out of Springfield and we can quantify any changes that come. Thank you.
Questions of Alan before?
No, I would not so much a question, but just kind of another statement for those that are here and those that are watching at home. You know, when you really think about our $47 million operating budget, and we're looking at a deficit of just shy of a million or 983,000, you know, we're managing 2% of that. And I'm not saying that to minimize the importance of it, but when you think of all the assumptions that go into what we receive from the state and changes that happen down in Springfield that impact us, and you start to think about or anticipate, which we spend an awful lot of time doing, kind of what's next. Alan alluded to a potential property tax freeze, which we're all excited about, if that were to happen. But that has a very, very direct impact on our school budget and the finances associated with operating a school. So it's kind of a good news, bad news thing. And we're constantly trying to monitor and manage what that looks and feels like, as if we were all sitting at home, you know, experiencing this for the first time. So as you look at the tentative budget, and those that are sufficiently more knowledgeable and dealing through some of those details than I am, there's probably some frustration that's going to occur, because if you're not familiar with dealing with state budgets, it's not anything like any of us in the business community are really used to. But certainly use Alan and the team to help answer those questions, or make sure you get those questions to us so we can sufficiently answer them for you as we approach the fall. Thanks, Alan.
Okay, may I have a motion to adopt the resolution to display tentative budget as presented?
I move that the Lake Forest Community High School District 115 Board of Education adopt the resolution to display the tentative budget as presented.
May I have a second?
Second.
May I have a roll call vote, please, Madam Clerk?
Dr. Elliott?
Aye.
Mr. Mormon?
Aye.
Mr. Powers?
Aye.
Mrs. Kreiling?
Aye.
Mr. Lane?
Aye.
Mr. Schreiber?
Aye.
Mr. Markison?
Aye. Like to move on to the next item on the agenda, which is the LFEA collective bargaining agreement. Mr. Simic.
Thank you, Mr. Markison. One of the questions that was posed to me was to provide some sort of a backdrop to how did we get to where we are. And Mr. Markson, you touched on some of that, and I will add a little bit of color and detail to that. There is a five-year agreement and a great recession a number of years ago. In 2006, the then superintendent and the high school board agreed to a five-year deal with the LFEA, which bridged a $56 million construction project at the high school, adding what we now know as the Apple Store and many other school improvements. That agreement also happened to span the Great Recession. The agreement was for a series of 6%, which was a step plus base increase annually. Combined with the enormous change in new construction with Barrett College, the Municipal Services Area Project, and every other development other than Amberley Place, and a drop of all existing property valuations, that agreement led to significantly reduced fund balances for the district, which reached near crisis proportions. Impressively, through early belt tightening and discretionary freezes, the district managed to avoid any cuts to programs. Then came the Path to Black agreement. The deficits from the preceding five-year agreement necessitated what became known as the Path to Black, with the district working hard to communicate and achieve more healthy fund balances and the ability to live within the district's means. After the five-year agreement, the LFEA agreed to a one-year hard freeze. Hard freeze means that both step and increment, or base increases, were zero. District 115 was alone in the region with a hard freeze. Following that one-year contract, the LFEA and the board were unable to arrive at a successor agreement before the start of the school year. Then came the strike. In the fall of 2012, the LFEA went on strike for 5 days. The board and the LFEA finally arrived at a four-year agreement based upon a CPI assumption, which the LFEA had estimated to be much higher than the board estimated at that time. Yes, the board's estimates wound up being much closer to what eventually happened and resulted in the LFEA experiencing no increase to their base in the first year, a 1.25% base increase the second year, no base increases the third year, and until this TA, no anticipated increase in the fourth year, and step increases totaling 2.5% per year. In contrast to the prior five-year agreement, which drove the district into the red, this agreement left the board in a better than expected position. There's also what was known as what I would call the aftermath. It's important to note that as soon as the strike ended, the LFEA and administrators began to work to avoid another strike. Administrators and LFEA representatives spent a full year listening to each other. 2 years after the strike, we established what was known as 5-on-5, which is five administrators graders and 5 LFEA members. And the second year was also spent doing a lot of listening and asking questions of each other in the hope of one day being able to sit down and work productively to problem solve. Also, a year after the strike, the board undertook the mission and vision work, which included board administrators, LFEA, and LFEA member teachers. These meetings led to beneficial conversations about how we all intended to live with each other, which were fueled by the growing realization that our culture was eating our strategies for lunch. It's impossible to measure lost opportunity costs, but we can say with conviction that we did little other than bargain or talk about bargaining for a very long time. We can also say that the cost could be measured not just in teaching and learning, but also financially. Substantial legal bills during that time. With the current TA on the table, our bargaining legal bills are estimated to be a mere $5,000. So that number for the upcoming agreement will be compounding, but it's hard to measure, but undeniable that our poor relationships also had compounding costs. It's also no accident that the partnership milestone of the mission and vision spoke directly to that issue. Partnership, quote from the board adopted mission, vision, and milestones under partnership. Effective communication promotes high trust partnerships among the board, faculty, staff, students, and parents. Both former presidents Bergener and Block pressed over the course of this past year for avoiding the final year of the contract in interest of securing a labor agreement and also establishing a different and more productive way of working together for the LFEA, the board, and the administration. Over the course of this past year, the board established parameters for the administration and board team to enter into conversations with the LFEA. Frankly, most of us thought at one point or another that it was a fool's errand. The LFEA board process and TAA represent many firsts on the path to realizing the ambitions of that partnership milestone. Among them, the first time in anyone's memory that the LFEA did not propose and the membership did not pass an intent to strike. The first time that the LFEA agreed to sidebars or smaller groups of productive working teams on items of shared interest and concern. And the first time in anyone's memory that the district reached an agreement amicably and ahead of schedule. In sum, the tentative agreement before the board is a culmination of 3 years of hard work and the charge of the board at that time and some of the members seated here over the course of that time to see create a more productive and collaborative approach to our labor relations, one that focuses much more on problem solving collaboratively. And with that, Mr. Markison, thank you.
Mr. Albus, well, first, are there any questions of Mr. Simic on his presentation. Is Mr. Albus or Dr. Wilcox or somebody going to walk us through?
Yes, that I'd like to ask Mr. Albus to walk us through some of the you're going to touch on some of the financial aspects, and then I will touch on some of the language things within the contract. Okay.
I know the board understands this because we've talked about it. As I look out at the audience and I see the people who are here, I know they're going to understand it as I talk about it. But for the benefit of somebody watching at home, I'm going to recap some of the vernacular that we tend to use on these contracts. Teachers are paid on a salary schedule, and that's on our website. It's part of the contract that's posted. And a schedule is comprised of years of experience and education. So depending on how many years of experience and the degree of education, you can find where those two lines intersect, and that's the negotiated schedule. So when we talk about experience, we also call that the step, and I'm going to refer to that. And Mr. Simic, I think, mentioned that we're looking at a 2.5% increase in the aggregate step cost, and that's our historical, 2.7% increase. If you take everybody on the schedule and move them down a year, that's the cost of that experience change. There's also what's called a base increase, and that changes at the very first cell, and then everything else is indexed off of that. So I'm going to reference both of those as I recap the contract. It is the one-year agreement for 15-16, and the existing contract calls for a step increase. So that's a 2.7% increase. The tentative agreement that's before you tonight would maintain that step of 2.7%, but add a 1% on the base, so a total of 3.7. Or in the note that I have here, 3.79. So that's for the year that we're in now. And by the way, those figures have been incorporated into the budget that we just presented. For 16-17, the base increase is 0.75% of 1%. And for those employees hired after the 11-12 school year, so hired after the strike, they would also receive the experience step increase. For employees hired prior to the strike, they would get a 0.75% base increase plus a step and a half on the experience. Additionally, teachers who are in what's called longevity, so they're basically off the schedule, but they haven't declared their retirement yet, would get a $500 non-compounding payment. The all-in estimated cost in negotiations, you take a snapshot of your staff and you freeze that, and then you move that forward so that you have a consistent way of measuring. It's 4.42%. Often the actual cost will vary from that slightly because you have attrition and retirements that occur. In 17-18, the contract is formula-based, which is very common in this industry now. The base increase would be 50% of the consumer price increase that we use for our revenue calculation, plus the stop cost. So if CPI is 1%, the base increase would be 0.5%. If CPI is 3%, the base increase would be 1.5%. Again, plus the step increase. In 18-19, the base increase would be 60% of the CPI number. And in 18-19, those hired prior to 11-12 would again receive a step and a half. Additionally, in 18-19, there would be a $500 non-compounding payment to those in longevity but who have not declared retirement. So if you utilize the CPI of 2.25, the all-in estimated 18-19 cost would be 4.4%. It's a lot of the numbers to throw out. But again, it breaks down to two components. The step cost varies by 0.1% each year, but it's usually around 2.5, 2.7, 2.3. And then the base increase is, as I've articulated, 1% in this current year, 0.75 in 16-17, and then 50% of whatever the CPI number is going to be in 17-18, and then 60% of that CPI number in 18-19. Any questions on that component?
Lots of numbers. I'll try and throw some more at you. So is it correct to say, Alan, that the average step increase for this 4-year period would be 2.8%?
I would say yes. Okay. Usually that's fairly stable.
But depending on, you know, you don't know the exact mix of teachers, but yeah, 2.5, 2.7. So assuming CPI is the 2.25% that you estimated in years 3 and 4, 18-19, what is the average all-in average increase of this 4-year tentative agreement?
I have a cheat sheet. I don't think I have the 4-year average.
Well, the average I thought was about, from your cheat sheet that I saw, was either 3. What I'm trying to get is what the additional increase above step is over this 4-year tentative agreement. And I thought the average was about 3.8 or 3.9. Which is about 1.2% on average greater than the step.
It's, I don't have it on this sheet. No.
I also wanted to address some of the language components of the tentative agreement. First of those, very important, about teacher evaluations. There is a best in class teacher evaluation tool that we have not been using, and there is an agreement to move towards a Danielson. We've been working with a very modified Danielson evaluation tool that it is safe to say was not working for anyone. It was very frustrating for teachers to know how they were doing. It was very, very frustrating for administrators to be able to utilize the tool effectively. And so there's an agreement to move towards that clear Danielson model, which I think is a benefit for everyone involved. We also have a clarification memorializing the parent-teacher conference day that sets the current practice of a late start or a non-attendance day for students following the parent-teacher conference day. There is some additional flexibility for the administrators related to our in-house professional development, known as KTIs, for those offerings. The tentative agreement also establishes a sick bank comprised of member-donated days. It also allows those sick leave to be utilized for religious leave instead of personal days. And finally, and very importantly, it establishes a schedule committee to collaboratively develop a new student schedule by the end of this calendar year, December 31st, 2015. And the new schedule must meet the requirements, the principles outlined in the collective bargaining agreement. There's a great deal of interest in from both sides on working on establishing a new, what was called a work day. And so the sides will agree to meet as many times as necessary to establish that, and going forward, that new schedule will be applied, and it also winds up being an important thing for the contract to continue on for the final 3 years that new schedule be agreed upon.
Can't be overemphasized the importance of establishing a different way of working together, and most importantly, all caps, underlined in bold, eliminates the possibility of an interruption in school, in any school year for the next 4 years. So that being said, are there any comments or questions from the board?
First, I'd like to thank everybody that worked really hard on this for the last couple of years. I think everybody in the community saw the strike as a real low point for the community and for the high schools especially. The fact that at that time, the administration and board included, and the certified teaching staff did not get along, and that was obvious. But with the disagreement, I do think we will have it couldn't even have come to fruition without an extreme cultural shift. And I'm convinced that a happy teacher becomes a better teacher, and the bottom line is this is going to be good for the students.
Thoughts or
questions? Yeah, I'd like to add a couple things. You know, there's an old saying, if you always do what you've always done, you'll always get what you've always gotten. And I think it was pretty clear to the board, and I think it was pretty clear to our teacher colleagues that some of the practices that we deployed in the past weren't allowing any of us to feel as though we were truly achieving something that we all know can be greatness within our school. And so, you know, when I was asked to run for this position, and went through the League of Women Voters debate, I think the comment that I made at that point when asked about the strike is I made the comment and it was the best of times and the worst of times. The best of times being it was resolved, the worst of times referring to the fact that we had to go through that. And that's a challenge for all of us to think about, because at any given day, irrespective of what our desires are personally or collectively, you know, you're always going to get these surprises, and there's always going to be some obstacles in your way. And I felt and was very critical of the administration. I think the comment I made 2 years ago to Mike and the team was, you know, now it's time to lead. So as much as we as board members were frustrated with the process, and I know the community members certainly were, and I know the teachers in the union and everybody had their own sets of anxiety, I really put a lot of pressure on the administration to say, okay, show me what you got. And if we're going to start working on this, we need to work on it now, as opposed to waiting till the end of the agreement and then everybody catapult in a very hasty, frustrated, anxious way to try to get it resolved. And you deserve credit, Mike, and Dr. Lori Wilcox and the LFEA team, who decided that, you know, we're not going to keep doing stuff the same way. We're going to do it different. And so we were all rather skeptical when we had an opportunity to catapult into this in the February timeframe, trying to get it done by the end of the year, which was unheard of, but we very successfully were able to skillfully, you know, navigate through all those obstacles, including spring break and including a whole lot of other things that crept into that. It's about changing the culture. And if there is one message that I hope we collectively can all share, it's as much as I have, I mean, you know, look, we have a responsibility to spend the taxpayers' money as efficiently and as effectively as possible. And we're spending the money and we're making the investment. And I have some anxiety around latter years and how we're going to manage through it. But you know what? I have all the confidence in the world we can do it together. We've navigated our way out of a lot worse situations, as you just saw within the last hour. And I think it's really important that we start to think differently and act differently. And the best way to do that is starting to change the culture. As Reese pointed out, if we can start inspiring our kids more, I mean, that's the good stuff, right? And the fact that we, you know, we like and respect and need our teachers, and we need them to be fully engaged in this process. I'm not saying just, okay, a great contract all of a sudden makes that happen. But it certainly removes a lot of doubt and hopefully puts a lot of confidence in the teachers that are in there every single day doing things above and beyond what we've asked them to do to try to make a difference. And we're about educating all our kids, and we've spent a lot of time doing that, and I for one am very pleased that we've come to this conclusion, because it touches on every single milestone. So what we've committed to the community and what we spent a lot of time on is achievement, instruction, assessment, faculty, partnership, and environment. And when you think of what this deal does and how we want to start opening up class options for kids and how we want to start driving that learning continuum, not only this next year, but the year after that and so on. I think we're doing what we said we were going to do. I think the administration is doing what I've challenged them to do personally, and I'm very proud of the team for the result that they've developed, and look forward to what's to come. Thanks.
I'd just like to add briefly a special thanks, publicly acknowledge the past board members, the scars that they had from the strike, and the continuity of having a staggered board for them to inform this board on the unintended consequences of certain decisions that, you know, would be coming up to us, and having the courage to, despite the scars, to look at it and approach it in a different way, thinking positively and reaching out to want to change the relationship with the union, and just can't thank them enough.
Okay. May I have a motion to approve approve a new collective bargaining agreement between Lake Forest High School District 115 and the Lake Forest Education Association for the period of July 1, 2015 through July 1, 2016 with an option for a three-year extension as contained therein and as discussed by the board in open session. Accordingly, further, the board terminates the collective bargaining agreement and evaluation plan between the board of Lake Forest Community High School District 115 and the Lake Forest Education Association, July 1, 2012 through July 1, 2016. May I have a motion?
I move that the Lake Forest Community High School District 115 Board of Education approve a new collective bargaining agreement between Lake Forest High School District 115 and the Lake Forest Education Association for the period of July 1, 2015 through July 1, 2016 with an option for a three-year extension as contained therein and as discussed by the board in open session. Accordingly, further, the board terminates the collective bargaining agreement and evaluation plan between the board of Lake Forest Community High School District 115 and the Lake Forest Education Association, July 1, 2012 through July 1, 2016.
Thank you. May I have a second?
Second.
May I have a roll call vote, please, Madam Clerk?
Mr. Mormon?
Aye.
Mr. Powers?
Aye.
Dr. Elliott?
Aye.
Mr. Lane?
Aye.
Mr. Schreiber?
Aye.
Mrs. Kreiling?
Aye.
Mr. Markison?
Aye. Motion passed. Is the approval of the dental and flex broker of record letter, which I know was discussed at the Finance Committee meeting. Is there any discussion needed on that or presentation? No. It was in our board packet. May I have a motion to approve the dental and flex contract as presented?
I move that the Lake Forest Community High School District 115 Board of Education approve the dental and flex broker of record letter as presented.
Second.
May I have a roll call vote?
Mr. Powers?
Aye.
Mr. Lane?
Aye.
Dr. Elliott?
Aye.
Mr. Schreiber?
Aye.
Mr. Mormon?
Aye.
Mr. Markison?
Aye.
Motion passes.
Next, I'd like to, this is the approval of press issue 88 and waiving the first reading. May I have a motion to waive the first reading of press issue 88? I skip.
We've got another motion for the dental flex contract.
Oh, I'm sorry. You're right. The first motion was about the dental and flex broker of record letter.
So just real quick, the technicality there is we have to change the broker of record first. Alan and Brittany, jump in if I say something that is untrue. And then we're moving to make some changes to the actual contract. Those changes are all additive and quite frankly, save us money based upon the consortium that we're working with. We think we'll get better services and
it saves us money.
May I have a motion to approve the dental and flex contract as presented?
I move that the Lake Forest Community High School District 115 Board of Education approve the dental and flex contract as presented.
Second.
Before you take the vote, I'd like to offer a couple of comments, which is the savings that we're looking at deriving are from the installation of what's called a silent network. So there's a process to go through of looking at what it costs to join the network and what discounts would be achieved. Now it's called silent because it's silent to the individual going to the dentist. There's no penalty for not being in the network, but there may be discounts achieved. So it may save as an individual, and it would save us as the employer of the plan. This does not change the dental benefits that are offered. It simply changes who is processing the claims. And again, then the implementation of the silent network is where the savings are coming from.
Mr. Moorman?
Aye.
Mrs. Scarley?
Aye.
Mr. Lane?
Aye.
Dr. Elliott?
Aye.
Mr. Schreiber?
Aye.
Mr. Powers?
Aye.
Mr. Markison?
Aye.
Motion passes.
Now on to that press issue 88. May I have a motion to waive the first reading of press issue 88?
I move that the Lake Forest Community High School District 115 Board of Education waive the first reading of press issue 88.
Second.
Roll call vote.
Mr. Powers?
Aye.
Mr. Moorman?
Aye.
Dr. Elliott?
Aye.
Mrs. Kreiling?
Aye.
Mr. Lane?
Aye.
Mr. Schreiber?
Aye.
Mr. Markison?
Aye.
Motion passes.
I continue on that. May I have a motion to approve press issue 88, second reading as presented?
I move that the Lake Forest Community High School District 115 Board of Education approve press issue 88 on second reading.
Second.
All in favor, or I'm sorry, roll call vote.
Mr. Schreiber?
Aye.
Mr. Powers?
Aye.
Dr. Elliott?
Aye.
Mr. Moorman?
Aye.
Mrs. Kreiling?
Aye.
Mr. Lane?
Aye.
Mr. Markison?
Aye.
Motion passes.
Thank you. The next item on the agenda is the Kathleen O'Hara Consulting Contract. Mr. Simic, would you like to make some comments about that?
Yes, sir. So I recommend the board approve the Kathy O'Hara Consulting Agreement as presented. Mrs. O'Hara does a number of different things, and I may ask Mr. Rogers to come forward and speak as is necessary here. She coordinates the student volunteer services during the school year, coordinates all of the service activities of the high school clubs and organizations, coordinates the Open Doors Job Shadow Program, which is one of the programs that is particularly interesting on testing days. We have an increasing number of students that participate in that, and that allows the students to have a great deal of human capital in the district, and we have adults that are interested in sharing their work lives for a half a day with students. Students go all across the community and communities surrounding us. I go down to the city. It's one of the things I've heard from parents as the single best thing their kid did in the school year. One student went down, he's interested in construction, spent a half a day at a construction company, came back with a hard hat, glasses, and was over the moon about it. He's also a liaison for a variety of school projects and community groups. We're going to be utilizing Mrs. O'Hara's services now and into the future in increasing ways because of the direction that we're taking with increasing internships in the district. One of the new AP classes, AP seminar, is very much designed for personalized projects, and that's what Ms. O'Hara specializes in, connecting adults that share an interest in the community with a teacher that has that interest, and then finally with a student that is interested in pursuing it. So we recommend this, approving this as presented.
Mr. Rogers, would you like to make any other evidence or thoughts on this?
Yeah, I would just add that Ms. O'Hara has a proven track record at all those initiatives, but she's not resting on her laurels. This past year, she worked closely with our assistant principal, Mr. Sullivan, developing a career connections program, providing opportunities and internships for students at cutting-edge facilities like Rosalind Franklin. So I think she's been a great asset to the school as we started to roll out another exciting initiative with the Innovation Incubator, and we wanted to have our students present to the Chamber of Commerce. She proved to be a fantastic resource and liaison through that experience. Thank you.
Sure.
Mr. Lane?
Barry, why, help me understand this. I don't know a lot about what she's done. And again, everybody forgive me. I'm fairly new to the board still now in 3 months. But why do we need an outside coordinator for that, or a contract employee for that, as opposed to having people who are full-time employees internally at the high school managing those activities? They all sound fantastic, and I don't want any of them to be dropped, but I just don't understand why we would need somebody as an outside contractor.
Right. I think there's lots of different ways you can I guess, arrange your resources to fill different needs. I was fortunate in walking through the school 2 years ago to have Ms. O'Hara already in place. And I think what she did is she brought a wealth of experience, some would say a lifetime of experience in this community, building those connections. So certainly we could bring somebody in. I can think even certainly somebody like me, brand new, walking through the door, another one of our fine employees doing that. I think the reason that I think all arrows point to Ms. O'Hara, because she really does have a proven track record and this ability in this realm. So I think there's a lot of value add right there. And again, if you appointed somebody else or shuffled the deck in some of the ways, I'm certainly you could do that. But again, I was fortunate to inherit her services in our community. A community seems to be very pleased with working with her. I can tell you that when I've worked with the different stakeholder groups, they're very familiar with Ms. O'Hara. She knows who the key players are. She knows how to maximize those resources and really get value out of those relationships.
David, wasn't your question why is she a contract employee instead of an employee?
That's part of my question. But I mean, when I read about a contract employee, typically they're a bridge. They're not a permanent contract employee, because if you need that service year in, year out, you usually make them an FTE. So what I heard you say is that she has tremendous contacts that did help you walking in the door to get it done. But I just would hope that we transition that over to somebody who's already here, or make the case for an FTE as opposed to a contract employee. So I don't really understand why we're approving a contract role in that position.
Sure, and it may be something worth looking into in the future. I think that there are also sometimes actually opportunities and advantages to bring in a contract employee for something as when you have a specific need. We have another example where we have our programmer, Thor Benson. He's our programmer. He helps with a lot of things behind the scenes. He's a retired employee, as is Ms. O'Hara. The costs and expenses that are involved with sometimes hiring a contract employee is much less. You're not getting into all of the pension expenses. You're not getting into all the benefits you may be otherwise. So I think, and I'll go out on a little bit of a limb here, I'm not the finance guy, but I think there is a value proposition there, and I think we're doing well in that realm.
Yeah, I don't know what we would be if we had an employee. The all-in cost for Ms. O'Hara is $53,000. If we were to hire an employee and pay their retirement, it would be really substantially more. So, as Mr. Rogers mentioned, it fills a specific need that we have. And it also happens to be something that she is really eager and able to do, and she doesn't need the benefits. She has benefits on her own. So we don't have to pay retirement costs, we don't have to pay insurance, we don't have to pay FICA and whatnot. And so what she would be, I don't know what she'd be making, but it'd be vastly less her salary. If our all-in cost for an employee were $53,000, the salary would be $20,000-$30,000 probably.
Yeah, I think Ted's words from a year ago kind of echoing in my head. This has nothing to do with Kathy O'Hara, who can run circles around me in a whole host of areas. I think the discussion we had last year was how do we look at delegating her responsibility in other areas without adding an FTE of people that are already in house. And I struggle with this last year, but I kind of played pseudo new guy and accepted it. I'm struggling with this times two now in terms of approving it. It's not necessarily about the money. It's about us thinking and doing things differently, like we just talked about before. And I think this is a perfect example of where we really need to do that.
We have the ability as a board to sit above the fray, and fortunately or unfortunately not have to deal as much with the day-to-day as who gets things done. But we have challenged Mr. Simic and this administration to look for new and different ways to do things with existing staff. And that includes all support staff, all admin staff, all school staff, all shared services staff. So I'm struggling with this too, as we all are, and it's not about the money so much as if we are going to work in a new and different way, we would like the staff to look for new and different ways to do things. So I might take the new guy exemption on this one if the administration feels strongly about it, but it's hard. This one's hard.
I guess to bring everyone up to date, last year I think I was the only no vote because, again, I like Mrs. O'Hara. She's a nice person. But at the end of the day, this is, you know, we do have to look for ways where we can, you know, save funds. And $53,000 in a $40 million budget isn't a whole lot. But it's also, you know, nickels add up if we are willing to look at new and different ways. And I would think that her job functions can be parceled out to other staff members. I also have a problem with her contract that says she can only be terminated if she breaches provision one or Article 1 and Article 1. It says she'll serve, you know, basically perform her duties at her time and whenever it's almost impossible to breach the contract, and that's the only way she could be terminated. So I have a problem with that too. That you know, at the end of the day, she's contract is bulletproof for her, not for us.
Any more discussion or comments or questions of Mr. Rogers, Mr. Simic? May I have a motion to approve the Kathleen O'Hara consulting contract in the amount of $53,000?
I move that the Lake Forest Community High School District 115 Board of Education approve the Kathleen O'Hara consulting contract in the amount of $53,000.
Second.
May I have a roll call vote, please, Madam Clerk?
Mr. Powers?
No.
Mr. Schreiber?
Aye.
Mr. Lane?
No.
Dr. Elliott?
Aye.
Mr. Mormon?
No.
Mrs. Kreiling?
Aye.
Mr. Markson?
Aye. Next on the agenda is the Whipple Consulting Contract. Mr. Simic, would you like to speak to that?
Thank you, Mr. Markson. The last time Mrs. Whipple's contract was renewed, it was for 3 years, and at that time, she'd been contracted with the district for roughly 24 years. I was convinced at that time that she would be a valuable member of the cabinet, and everything she has done since then has reinforced those convictions. Her work during the strike, the artful collaboration with this District 65 and 67, developing the new website for skill and guiding large-scale group processes like the mission, vision, and milestones, and most notably your extensive relationships with key stakeholders in the village, in the city, and the Chicago media community make her more than valuable. As a cabinet member, it's no exaggeration to say that she is invaluable to the team around her and to the organization which she has served so eagerly, ably and earnestly. This new agreement is for 12 months. It is a one-year agreement. In the past, it has been a 10-month agreement. This is for a 12 months. It includes a 1.5% increase, which is just below CPI, and I recommend its approval. There have been a number of questions about this over the past couple months, and a significant amount of detail added to that, including the number of years that Mrs. Whipple has served with the districts, the number of contracts that she's had over the past 5 years, which is three. There's a three-year agreement, a one-year agreement, and a one-year agreement. The amounts of her annual earnings over that time. There's one of the questions was related to district-related expenses over the five-year period. Mrs. Whipple had a sum total of $11.19 for district-related expenses. Question about whether her business trips or conferences that she had attended were district paid. She's attended a variety of conferences, and not one of those were paid by the district. The attorney has reviewed this and made a number of suggestions to the way that the manner in which Mrs. Whipple works, and we'll be working with our district attorney to review those and address those moving forward. And I recommend approving the contract as presented. The comps are difficult. It is difficult to compare a contracted employee with employees in other districts, in part because of her very extensive tenure in our district and in our community. There's a different level of value there, and also the scope of her responsibilities is very, very different than what many districts utilize for communications people. Some are executive assistants, others are secretaries. Many are in and out of the organization. One of our neighbors, they're on their fourth communications person in 4 years, one of our high school districts. So there's a added benefit of a very long tenure and really, really good performance from Mrs. Whipple. Thank you.
Thank you. I mean, most people know, I mean, Mrs. Whipple also does work for 67. She's a shared service consultant. I didn't know Ann Whipple before 7 months ago. I've gotten to know Ann Whipple very well. This community is lucky to
they have Ann Whipple, in my opinion. She's connected, smart, and respected by a lot of people in and outside this community, and that helps us tremendously in everything that we do. Any other comments or discussion or questions for Mr. Simic?
Yeah, I'd like to add just a few. Those of you that were paying attention a couple of months ago, I was kind of the member that asked that this contract be tabled until we had a chance to actually look into the details. I think I also used my dad's famous line of why spoil a good story with a few facts, because when you hear stories about the agreement and the types of work that Ann was involved in, it didn't end up necessarily adding up. We do not pay for her health club membership or a country club membership or any of those things that have kind of floated around town. I also made the statement that I look forward at a further meeting supporting Ann and supporting this agreement, which I do before you do this evening. I've spent a lot of time with Ann over the last 3 months, specifically, mostly because, you know, one of the things that caught me by surprise was she's our director of communications. As it turns out, she's really kind of Mike's chief of staff in a whole lot of ways and does a lot more stuff. She's worked directly for the district for 19 years. She's very well connected, as Reece said. She's also incredibly dedicated, fun to work with. I think I said classy last time, and I'm going to say classy again this time, because oftentimes the hours in which we're dumped on her phone or on her lap or in her office aren't necessarily the most attractive in terms of perfect timing to deal with issues. So proud to be a supporter of Ann's, proud to support this contract, and proud to work with her going forward.
Any other comments or questions?
Yeah, I have to. I was also with Mr. Powers asking that it be tabled. At the time, I was concerned there was a clause C that it being a 10-month contract, you know, what was the billing history, and prior to that, the contract was rewritten to my satisfaction. It was changed to a one-year contract at the same price. So, in effect, we do get those 2 months now, and we know what the cost is, the all-in cost. So, I'll support it this time.
May I have a motion to approve the Whipple Consulting Contract in the amount of $97,250?
I move the Lake Forest Community High School District 115 Board of Education approve the Whipple Consulting Contract in the amount of $97,250.
Second.
Second.
Roll call vote, please, Madam Clerk.
Mr. Mormon?
Aye.
Mrs. Carling?
Aye.
Mr. Lane?
Aye.
Dr. Elliott?
Aye.
Mr. Schreiber?
Aye.
Mr. Powers?
Aye.
Mr. Marcus?
Aye.
Motion passes.
Thank you. The next item on the agenda is the concrete foundation
for the maintenance building. I know there were some questions about this at the Finance Committee meeting yesterday, so I don't know if Mr. Powers, do you want to take this with Mr. Albus? Mr. Albus?
Yeah. Also, the amount here is different than the amount we've reflected in the budget, or am I missing something? I thought it was 290,000 I saw on the proposed budget. Oh, I stand corrected. Foundation only, no building. Well, there you go. We're saving something.
There's a lot of history on this one, and I'll try to be succinct. In 2005, the district purchased a house on Edgewood that was used as the staging office for all the renovations that occurred between 06 and 08. And at the end of the construction, the house was demolished, but we held on to the garage. Then fast forward to 2013 when we looked to rebuild the track. When we rebuilt the track, it was a redesign. So it wasn't simply taking up the existing footprint. It was going from four lanes to six lanes, and that changed the reconfiguration. The casualty of that is that the bleachers on the east side of the track and the storage underneath had to be demolished to make room for the track. So in putting together the debt issuance to fund that project, we also included money for a variety of other maintenance projects. That included some storage buildings. Now at the time for East Campus, we estimated something like $70,000 to replace a dilapidated garage. Then we added, I think, $116,000 for a storage facility out at West Campus. As we talked and really came to the realization that what we were using the storage under the east side bleachers for, doing maintenance work, changing oil, making repairs, that wasn't an adequate space. It wasn't heated, we didn't have running water in there, it wasn't set up environmentally like it needed to be. And so this garage started to grow in cost because of the environmental requirements, the fire requirements around storing vehicles and fuel. And so when we went out to bid, we bid the building previously, and the boards approved that. I think that was around $61,000. What we're recommending, and you see the bids in front of you tonight, we received two for the construction of the foundation, half construction or builders at $236,000, and Stuckey construction at $231,900. Leads us to believe that our specs are fairly good because these are tight bids. But that still seems like a lot of money for a foundation. We talked about this extensively yesterday at the finance meeting. Mr. Mormon asked for more of a breakout, and you should have received that yesterday afternoon. We contacted our architect.
I did, and basically, it appears what the architect did was he just took the bid and backed their number into it, because surprisingly the architect's Perkins and Will estimated it would be about $231,900. So either they're really, really good, or they just took the bid and backed it in. So I don't know. They should be paid full price.
No, I agree. I think he did back into it, but I think it's still a valuable document, because what it shows is if you go through it, it's not just the foundation. There's about $133,000 in demolition, in utilities, in plumbing, in electrical, in fire alarm, and in mechanical. So it's more than just a concrete foundation. One of the things I learned in this process, when I thought we were replacing a garage, was a garage is built on a concrete slab. When you heat it and you have the running water in it, then you need a foundation. So that adds to the cost. We have storage needs at West Campus and storage needs at the East. But again, this cost is much higher than what we thought it would be. Our recommendation is outlined in the memo to you, is to forego the West Campus storage at this time. Use the funds that were allocated for that. And also use, in the issuance that we did, we had $158,000 allocated for other projects. We're recommending dipping into that. So the combination of East and West Campus of $186,000, dipping into the $158,883 in the amount of $107,500 to pay for the construction of this storage facility at East Campus. Currently, somehow they shoehorn all of our equipment into that garage, which is dilapidated. And during the day, what they end up doing is backing all of the equipment out to get to the pieces that they need. We have been lucky during all the construction and during this period to have neighbors like the Farrells next to us, because they've been very patient. They were great neighbors during construction, but this is an eyesore to them, and we've been in contact over time. We've talked about the design of the building with the Farrells. I think they're supportive of it, and there's a big need, because that's a very tight high school campus. There's no other place on that campus that we have adequate storage.
Alan, where's the new building being constructed?
If you come out, if you're in the wedge and you take it, you walk all the way through to the east side, and you come out and you go down the stairs, so out kind of by the cafeteria. If you look across, you see a parking lot, and then there's an open area, and there's a butterscotch color garage. That's the garage that we're looking to demolish, replace, and build the storage facility. We've designed it so the access would be from our side, so it wouldn't interfere with the Farrells. And over time, we will need to do some landscaping. That's one concession Kathy Cerniak wanted. We have some landscaping in here, but we'll look at that. and I think this will meet our needs. It's built right for the work that needs to be done, and we recommend approval.
And I would just add, first of all, thank you to the Farrells for your patience, because I wouldn't have been so patient. So I'll share that right up front. The scope has changed a little bit too, because I think it's important, and Carol White's worked on this significantly over for the better part of a year, maybe even longer. So there's hazardous materials, because there's fuel storage there too, which requires a dramatic change in why there's a cost for a concrete slab that's $231,000 and change, which normally, I mean, I could just see the press now, you know, Lake Forest District approves a foundation for $200,000. It is much more extensive than that, and what it allows us to do then is to work on that equipment inside the shed in winter time, so they can do tractor repair and truck repair and all kinds of other things. So it's highly engineered. Yes, it's borderline expensive to anybody that's used to doing similar projects, but I think it's very reasonable, and I think the value that we'll get, I think really is you know, supportive to the project.
I'd also like to say, Mr. and Mrs. Farrell, thank you very much for being here, and thank you very, very much for working so well with and patiently with Mr. Albus. We know that we're a very large neighbor, and we know that that has certain benefits and certain consequences at times. And I'd also like to say thank you to Mr. Albus, who works very hard to work with the neighbors that we have, and I hope you continue to express your needs and interests to Mr. Albus, and I hope we continue to be responsive to that. It's very important for us as a community organization. It's very important to the board also that we be good neighbors. So thank you very much for being here, and I hope that we continue to have the same level of communication that we've had. Thank you.
Can't see.
Oh, I have one more question. At the finance meeting yesterday, we discussed a possible opportunity to work with the city, or you know, having some of our maintenance work done by them as a shared service type.
Yep, I apologize. I meant to address that in my comments and kind of got away from me. Carol reached out to her counterpart at the city, and looking at their usage, I don't know how feasible that would be, but as we talked it through, and we said we'd talk about the logistics, I don't know that we'd get a whole lot of relief here, because we still have the storage need, and we'd still want to be able to work on the equipment, and so we'd still have to heat it. We'd still incur the electrical cost. Not a lot of this would go away. In addition, though, because then we said, well, if it doesn't work with the city, would we be better off building something at West Campus that could service all of our equipment? But then you're transporting back and forth, and there's an efficiency loss in that as well. And we still have the storage need over at East. We couldn't house everything here and transport it back and forth daily. That'd be highly inefficient. So we did. It was a very healthy conversation, I think, in going through that. But that's kind of where we landed after drilling down on it.
Any other questions or comments? There be none. May I have a motion to approve Concrete Foundation Plus for maintenance building in the amount of $231,900?
I move that the Lake Forest Community High School District 115 Board of Education approve the Concrete Foundation for Maintenance Building in the amount of $231,900 as presented.
Second.
Dr. Elliott?
Aye.
Mr. Powers?
Aye.
Mr. Mormon?
Aye.
Mrs. Carling?
Aye.
Mr. Lane?
Aye.
Mr. Schreiber?
Aye.
Mr. Markson?
Aye.
Motion passes.
Next is our human resources report. May I have a motion to approve the human resources report as presented?
I move that the Lake Forest Community High School District 115 Board of Education approve the human resources report as presented.
May I have a second?
Second.
Roll call vote, please.
Mr. Schreiber?
Aye.
Mr. Mormon?
Aye.
Mr. Powers?
Aye.
Mr. Lane?
Aye.
Dr. Elliott?
Aye.
Mrs. Carling?
Aye.
Mr. Markson?
Aye. This is our consent agenda. Bear with me. May I have a motion to approve the consent agenda items, including disbursements, payrolls, and financial statements for June 2015. Approval of a Honeywell Instant Alert one-year contract renewal in the amount of $2,613. Approval of Atlas Curriculum Software Licensing Agreement in the amount of $13,250. The minutes of the regular meeting, June 9th, 2015. Minutes of an executive session, June 9th, 2015. Minutes of a special meeting, June 22nd, 2015. Minutes of an executive session, June 22nd, 2015. Disposal of audio recordings of January 14th, 2014. May I have a motion?
I move that the Lake Forest Community High School District 115 Board of Education approve the consent agenda items as presented.
May I have a second, please?
Second.
Roll call vote, please.
Mr. Schreiber?
Aye.
Mr. Mormon?
Aye.
Mr. Powers?
Aye.
Mr. Lane?
Aye.
Dr. Elliott?
Aye.
Mrs. Kreling?
Aye.
Mr. Markson?
Aye. Thank you. Next are some FOIA requests. We have a FOIA from Steve Goldman, resident, and two FOIAs from Nancy Thorner, resident. Next are some announcements. Can't believe this. Summer goes by too quickly when you have to make these announcements. Friday, August 21st, 2015, will be freshman orientation already. Wow. Frightening. Monday, August 24th, will be the first day of school for all students. Then comes Labor Day. Monday, September 7th, is a Labor Day holiday where there will be no school. The next Board of Education meeting is scheduled for Tuesday, September 8th at 6:30 p.m., half hour earlier, starting in the fall, in this very West Campus boardroom. Not on the agenda, but I'd like to make a personal comment. One of our board members is moving and will be resigning at the end of the month, Dave Schreiber. I've gotten to know Dave pretty well. We were both involved in some of the LFEA discussions. We kicked each other under the table a bit and rolled our eyes a few times and learned a lot together. So I'd like to thank you on behalf of the whole board for everything that you've done, Dave, and good luck as you move your family out to Colorado. So thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Thanks, everybody.
Thank you.
May I have a motion to adjourn the Lake Forest Community High School District 115 board meeting?
So moved.
Second?
Second.
Voice vote. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Meeting adjourned.